Hello friends, and welcome to another episode of Economic Sutra. In this episode, we are going to explore the field of cartography and geospatial mapping. Now, you may think that this is a somewhat esoteric sector, but any of you who are using Google Maps or even maybe going to an NCC camp and making your way using a handheld map old style will know that cartography is actually a critical sector. In fact, as we are becoming more and more digital, this sector is becoming even more critical, whether it's in terms of managing our municipal services or managing traffic or making your way to your friend's house using Google Maps or for defense purposes. You are using all kinds of cartographic tools all the time, even if you sometimes do not even know it. Now, in India, this sector used to be quite heavily regulated till very recently. To a large extent, it was a monopoly of the Survey of India, and even when private parties were partaking in the sector, they had to take a lot of government permissions. Now, as of February 2021, many of these restrictions have now been liberalized. Obviously, there are some remaining restrictions for defense and security reasons, but by and large, we have opened it up, and this has led to an explosion of innovation in the sector. So we are going to explore many of these innovations in the next few minutes. But first, let me tell you a little bit of a story and history of the field of cartography. Then you will be able to appreciate why this is so important, both economically, geopolitically, as well as technologically. Now, the field of cartography, as we know it today, is really an invention of the early 1500s, or maybe late 1400s in Europe. Now, of course, some form of geospatial representation existed in ancient times, for example, for architectural maps and so on. And during the medieval period, for example, there used to be some route maps and things, particularly by both the Europeans, but also by the Arabs, by the Chinese, and so on. But the modern field of cartography has really evolved from the end of the 1400s. And it began to evolve really in the Iberian Peninsula, where both the Spanish and the Portuguese began to invest heavily into the business of making maps. Why were they doing this? Well, they had gone into exploring the oceans around them. As you know very well, the Spanish made their way to the Americas, and the Portuguese made their way into the Indian Ocean. Now, these original sort of first generation of maps, so to speak, these were state secrets. However, this could not last. So by the 1530s, the Dutch and the Flemish had managed to find out quite a lot about what was going on in these voyages. And they began to collect these information and began to create a new generation of maps. Now, unlike in the case of the Iberian Peninsula, the Dutch were much more private sector driven, far more freewheeling in the way they looked at maps. So what happened as a result of which, a lot of new information began to be added onto the maps, and there were a lot of new innovations in how maps were actually designed and portrayed. For example, there was a very famous map maker called Mercator. And when you look at most of your school atlases, the way you see the projection is called a Mercator projection. So this is from the mid-1500s, this Dutch map maker called Mercator who came up with that way of showing maps. There were many other innovations as well. Now, by the end of the 1500s, some of this map-making capability crossed the English Channel and went to the United Kingdom. Now, there was a very well-known Flemish map-maker called Hundius who set up shop there. And thanks to some of his influence, but others as well, the English then began to develop a lot of map-making capability. The French also began to do this. The English in particular were very, very keen on trying to map the oceans. For obvious reasons, they were a maritime country, so it's not very surprising that they were looking at various map-making options. But they then began to doing their own voyages, for example, by Drake, but also by pirates and many other kinds of sources of information. In fact, both the Dutch, but particularly the French and the British, were quite happy to steal information wherever they could find. And so as a result of it, by the early 1700s, it is the British who had some of the best map-making capability. In fact, they had surpassed the Dutch in their ability to make maps. Now, by the middle of the 1700s, you begin to see the British go out and begin to map some of the new territories that they had recently conquered in India and other places as well, but particularly India. And you have an army cartographer called Rennell, who carried out perhaps the first systematic mapping, not just of India, but any large territory anywhere in the world, which was the maps of Bengal and Bihar. So these were very famous maps of that time, done by James Rennell. Now, clearly, as this map-making capability began to grow, a new organization called the Survey of India was set up. And the Survey of India then carried out in the early 19th century something called the Great Trigonometric Survey of India. This was a systematic survey of India using trigonometric principles, which was carried out first by Lambton and then by George Everest. Many of you know the name because the highest mountain in the world, Everest, is named after him. And they carried out this trigonometric survey of India, which was a very detailed map of India. It was not merely for being able to map out the Indian subcontinent, but also it allowed them to work out for the very first time the curvature of the Earth, which was a very critical piece of information for a large maritime power of that time. So what you have here is a huge amount of innovation going on at the Survey of India, and much of it happening in India. So the Survey of India, in fact, would have been at the cutting edge of cartography in the 19th century, and people like Lambton and Everest would have been considered some of the greatest scientists of that time. However, there is a twist in this. And the twist is that because the British were carrying out much of this surveying for the purpose of actually being able to control a country that they had colonized, it also meant that they were very, very careful about sharing this information, because this has obviously had huge amount of defense and security usages. So as a result of which, while the craft of cartography and map making remained largely in the private sector and in Britain itself and in many other parts of Europe, in India, it became a monopoly of the Survey of India. Obviously, the British were not very keen on sharing the information that they had. And this was, of course, very important because this improved cartographic information was critical for their ability to first beat the French, but later on also beat the Marathas when they were conquering India. Now, in 1947, we became independent. Now, you would have thought that having become independent, we would take a different view of the Survey of India and its monopoly. Sadly, that is not what happened. Much of the earlier thinking about security and close control of cartographic information flowed through even into the subsequent decades. Now, perhaps in the initial decades, it may have been made some sense, but certainly by the 80s and 90s, much of this information was freely available through satellite photography to any of our geopolitical rivals. And in fact, by the 2000s, we were even able to get some of this information directly off Google. So this monopoly over time became largely irrelevant. Worse, this began to get in the way of private innovation in the sector. And remember, this is a sector that was going through all kinds of innovation in other parts of the world. Ironically, a lot of this innovation happened in India itself at the Google offices that was being used to experiment with a lot of this map making. In fact, Google Maps is at least partly developed in India. And yet, because the rules did not allow it, technically, till February of this year, Google Maps was actually a legal gray area. So all of you who were using Google Maps before March 2021, I'm afraid you may have been doing something that was on the wrong side of the law. But of course, the government recognized that the times had changed, and so very dramatic changes were done to the laws, and drastic reduction of restrictions was put in place, and as a result of which, we now have an explosion of innovation that is happening in cartography in India. And I'm going to take you through some of the interesting innovations in the next few minutes. But before that, let me say that this is a sector that is critical input into many of the other things that I will talk to you in this series. Just in the last episode, we looked at drones. And let me say, you can't have a large civilian use of drones or even a military use of drones unless you have good maps and 3D maps, if possible. So it is not a sector that is just important to itself, but has many, many usages in other sectors, whether it's, as I said, municipal management, traffic management, mapping out of property rights, defense, of course, everybody knows about, but also things like mining and things like managing climate change and adapting to it. So with that, let me now turn to some of the pioneers in this sector. MapMyIndia is one of the oldest cartography and geospatial company that there is in India. And I'm going to talk to them about how the field has been all these years and how this has changed post these reforms that we have introduced. So over to you, sir.
I'm Rakesh Verma. I'm happy that I founded MapMyIndia 26 years back. Also, I am the FICCI Geospatial Chair. When I took up the challenge of digitally mapping India, there were certain convictions. The conviction was related to the development of the country. And that happened after we came back from the United States, living there for 12 long years. We felt that digital maps can bring a change in lives of the people, whether it be citizens, businesses, or government. Little realizing what the uphill task I'll be facing over the years for a couple of reasons. One, the technology. India didn't have a foundational digital map database. Keeping that in mind, we said, okay, we'll build the digital map step by step, like they say, brick by brick. While doing that, it took us 10 long years. And fundamentally, when we found out that if you can solve the pain point of anyone, any businesses, or any government requirements, you are bound to innovate something. So in this whole process, the biggest challenge that, other than the technological challenge, the biggest challenge we came across when we wanted to launch our MapMyIndia.com internet portal, remember this portal came into place much prior to Google Maps came into existence anywhere worldwide. This innovation happened at MapMyIndia, but to release the internet map, we found out and came to know that we have to take the government approval. To get that approval, the interesting part was still the country was in the print and paper age. So we were asked to submit all the maps to the government department. Trust me, the map, digital maps, if I had to put it in a piece of paper, it came out in almost like a room of this size. But as a good citizen, as a company that always have followed the country's law, we respected that. It took us a week's time to print all those paper maps, and we handed it over in the North Block. The innovation, we did not stop. We said government one day will understand, one day will recognize the need of the digital maps for the development of the country. we also believe that while security is equally important, rather more important, but the development cannot be stopped at the cost of that. There are two different ways to look at it. However, we brought the digital maps into the cars. All the automotive cars that came in, MapMania maps got loaded, and still today it is loaded. Now, I'm not saying about, this was a challenge that MapMania faced. I really understand why the private sector entrepreneurs in this space, other companies, why they didn't come forward, why they stopped, they didn't do innovation. They continued to do services business, and these kinds of archaic laws really were impediments, made it very difficult for the Indian entrepreneurs to move forward. Today, I'm so happy. As a matter of fact, on February 14th, 2021, which is this year, calendar year only, it was like I literally cried when I heard that, got that news that Government of India has liberalized the mapping policy, made it absolutely easy for the Indian entities to go ahead and freely do the maps. Thanks to the government for taking that initiative.
In 2005, the map of the world began somewhere in the Atlantic and ended somewhere in the Pacific. Only the US, Europe, and the Western countries were mapped, maybe with the exception of Japan. And Google India had been born, and I was standing in the Google office overlooking the Vettel Malia Road and had this idea that if there are 4,000 people on this street, if you give them the power to map, one of them will map. And the idea of MapMaker was born. And me and another colleague of mine, Sanjay, we sat down and wrote a server for 2 years and brought maps of the first maps of India to life. That led to a worldwide program where 189 countries that you see on Google Maps today were mapped that way. And 4 billion people who did not have maps before now have maps. But this story was, very rough. Not just because, you know, in the technology community, it was not believed that this Indian ethos of people helping each other, where the citizens would map, would actually happen. There was lack of belief that people would do it things altruistically. And there was also a governance issue. My product counsel, when she was about to launch MapMaker in India, warned me that there is a small chance, because of the layers of ordinances, regulations, and policies across multiple departments, that I might go to jail for a few days because of launching MapMaker. And we had to be okay with that. And of course, Google could do that, and crazy people like us could do that, but not everybody would. And that is why this new geospatial policy that has been released is so revolutionary. It not only does away with all these regulations across all these departments, it simplifies it and does away with approvals altogether. Any citizen, as freely as they walk on the street of India, and any company can map India. And the only restriction you have is a small set of negative attribute list, which is publicly published. And there are no restrictions whatsoever for any Indian company to create maps.
So friends, you have heard how difficult it used to be to work as an innovator and a private sector player in this sector before these February 2021 reforms were done in the cartographic field. But now we're going to talk to some of the young hands in the sector who will show us some of the cool things that the cartography sector is now doing. And so over to you.
In a nutshell, we are able to now build a digital map twin of the real world that is digitally and geospatially representing or modeling the dynamically changing real world in near real time. We are able to use artificial intelligence. We are able to create very high definition, high precision maps, what we call four dimensional, not just 2D, but 3D, as well as updating in near real time, 4D maps. And this can change the way e-commerce happens. This can change the way virtual travel and tourism happens, the way governance happens. It can generate smarter, safer, self-driving cars. So the future is very exciting with the power of geospatial. I'll be happy to kind of tell you more.
Super. So why don't we go and have a look at some of the things you're doing?
Thank you. So as you see, what we've done is from drones, we've kind of flown them and then collected the data. You'll start seeing the video right now, which captures the images as well as the point cloud of it can be a rural area, it can be an urban area, and we'll show you kind of the three-dimensional maps we have created for a part of Gurgaon, where you can see each of the buildings. You can then do the measurements, see the full 3D model, like these high rises or the different schools. It can be used for any kind of planning or seeing that all the development that you did, was it as per the plan? And it can be used even for virtual tourism or real estate.
Thank you. Why don't you show us some more things?
Sure. So here basically we'll try to show you about different kinds of military applications, how you can use maps and three-dimensional geospatial technologies for looking at kind of route planning in, let's say, the Jammu and Kashmir area, or if you want to start seeing the full three-dimensional maps. You can kind of see this volumetric analysis or flood analysis. In case some flooding happens, then how that Kashmir Valley, for example, can suffer from some kind of damage. And this is all kind of indigenously generated, indigenously created. So the country has its own indigenous solutions. It's also something that India could technically export to other countries. We can offer this as a service or a capability to geopolitically friendly countries. So MapIndia also provides APIs for other app developers to build into their apps the power of maps through application programming interfaces. So for example, the Cowin portal needed to show to all the citizens where the nearby vaccine centers were by putting their location on the MapIndia map. So we provided our APIs. The Cowin software developers just wrote a few lines of code, and since March 1st, crores of citizens could log on to MapMyIndia using our APIs and see in the Cowin app where the nearest vaccine center was and how to get there. Similarly, people can build great vehicles using MapMyIndia by integrating navigation, connected services, shared mobility, and electric mobility solutions too. So India is a developer-friendly market, or a country full of technology developers. They can build great apps if they get great APIs. And I think that's the power of mapping, that it can service n number of industries for unimaginable use cases, because innovation is the limit for people.
Now, this is a very important point, because effectively cartography is not just about cartography itself, because it's an enabler for many other sectors. So once you get your maps right, and there are many, many different kinds of maps depending on the use, then it leverages to many other things that can be done. And from everything from improving your farm produce to delivery of your pizza can be dramatically enhanced by using better maps.
If data is the new oil, maps is the refinery. For example, in 2021, when we conduct the census of India, it will be the last census India will ever do. Data will be born instantaneously, it will be mapped instantaneously, it will come online and be useful and visible to all of us. When people are born, when children are born with their parents' Aadhaar and their location and time of birth, it will be recorded and it will move online into that cloud, and we will have a real-time census of India every minute and every hour. The next generation maps will be hyperspectral, hyper-precision, and hyper-layered. And the quality and depth of these will be so high that not only are they useful for governance in every economic activity, they'll be useful for security and sovereignty of the country.
This is how the people are making the maps. So these are basically all the medical places. And then you want to show the high definition maps here. So what you saw, that high definition map, which shows you the entire kind of 2D, 3D of a road, it's being marked here. So it's a full polygon. And what you're seeing here is basically every, it's a point cloud. So actually every point in space, the color of it and the 3D location of it is marked. And from that they are drawing what are the edges of the road, where the speed breakers, potholes, footpath. So using all this, you can also see how, where the breakages in the footpaths are. You can model it and then run analytics that, you know, on this road, there are so many parts which are poorly planned or you know. And then this is that from the drone, how they're making the 3D models, right? So this is, they're creating these ortho-rectified images.
What do you mean by ortho-rectified?
When the drone flies, get rid of the garbage. Yeah, when the drone flies, it's an oblique kind of sensor, but then you have to kind of you have to convert it to a perpendicular to the ground, and then you create a 3D model from that.
Yeah.
As you can see, this is used to create 360 degree maps, but you'd be amazed to know that one of the applications of this, it can also be used by Goods and Service Tax Network to assess where revenue leakage is happening.
I believe it, this is already being done.
Yes, between both Goods and Service Tax Network and the Central Board of Direct Taxes. That's how I think the government is bringing in transparency and economic reform. And this can have a big impact on the country's economy using geospatial technologies.
Wow, that's quite interesting. So why don't you explain quickly what these things are?
Got it. So our different cars have different sensors. This is a 360 degree camera, six cameras on each side. It already has inside it different cameras which are seeing in the front and the back, GPS sensors for location, and inertial sensors to measure acceleration or movement of the vehicle. Using this, we capture those 360 degree panoramas that I showed you. Here you are seeing different types of cameras. These are stereo cameras and a LiDAR laser, which is continuously scanning the area around it. On this map, you might get a sense of the real-time point cloud. So as I'm moving, you might see my object kind of reflected here. And this, whenever we are in the car, these systems are actually inside the car, and you can real-time kind of see what that vehicle is seeing. This is showing you the images that the camera is seeing. Once we kind of capture this information, it goes into our technology processing system to create this digital map twin.
Thank you, that was very, very interesting. So ladies and gentlemen, as you saw, cartography has many, many innovations coming our way. They range from being able to look at our cityscapes in 3D or our agricultural production in various kind of new ways. But also, of course, it even allows us to begin to improve our tax system, because many of these cars are going around your cities and are able to actually map out who is or is not paying your GST. Thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed this episode of Economic Sutra.